Hi everyone, my name is Emma Gatman. I'm coming from New York City and I'm really happy to talk today about my favorite topic, biomarkers of treatment response and also non-invasive biomarkers of atopic dermatitis. So in atopic dermatitis, we all know that blood biomarkers are not as informative as skin biopsies, and particularly in children. Thus, development of minimally invasive skin biomarkers is really important in both adults and particularly in children with atopic dermatitis, where obtaining skin biopsies may be impossible. Tape strips may provide useful means to investigate biomarkers in pediatric settings and in large clinical trials or longitudinal studies where biopsies are not really feasible or practical. Now, an important consideration for everybody doing biomarker work is the idea that atopic dermatitis is a really heterogeneous disease, unlike psoriasis that is more homogeneous across the disease. In atopic dermatitis, we have different clinical subtypes that were recognized, such as pediatric atopic dermatitis, African-American AD, Asian AD, and these have a variable immune polarizations and also epidermal barrier defects. For example, children with atopic dermatitis, they have Th2 activation, Th22 activation, they also have Th17 activation, but they don't have Th1 immune activation. African Americans similarly also do not have Th1 immune activation. Asians with AD also have much stronger Th17 polarization than in Europeans with atopic dermatitis. And these also relate to barrier defects, differences between the subtypes. Now, stratification of biomarkers specific to the different atopic dermatitis phenotypes will be important for development of a personalized medicine approach in atopic dermatitis, and I think we are heading towards that direction. So how are we testing the contribution of the different cytokines and the immune axis to atopic dermatitis? We are doing it through clinical trials with targeted treatments in atopic dermatitis patients. And of course, these are best when coupled with biomarkers, either skin or blood or both. So the first study that we learned a lot on pathogenesis of AD through this study was dupilumab. And we all know dupilumab, it's an anti-IL-4 receptor monoclonal antibody that targets IL-4 and IL-13 signaling. And IL-4 and IL-13 are really key to the barrier disruption in atopic dermatitis because they really participate in the downregulation of multiple key components of the barrier, such as terminal differentiation components, lipids, and claudins. And in this study, and this was the phase 2 study in which dupilumab was given to 27 patients in the beginning, placebo to 27 patients. And in this study, dupilumab reduced significantly multiple markers and not only type 2 related markers, such as one would think, such as CCL17, CCL18, CCL26, and others, but also beyond those, including Th17 and Th22 regulated genes, such as the S100, IL-17A itself, CXCL1. So there was modulation beyond the type 2, but importantly, there was not a modulation of the Th1 immune axis. The Th1 immune axis with markers such as interferon gamma, CXCL9, mostly stayed untouched by dupilumab. Now, dupilumab also reversed the atopic dermatitis barrier in this 16-week study. So we see at baseline by age and staining that hyperplasia that is really characteristic to atopic dermatitis patients. That skin thickening is completely modified at week 16, in which the lesional skin looks very similar to non-lesional skin. Keratin 16 immunostaining is completely turned off, mostly by week 4, but completely at week 16. It's not happening in the placebo arm. And the epidermal thickness of the entire patient population is reduced 40% at week 16, already 20% at week 4. That's not happening in the placebo arm. And the million-dollar question is, what happens to filaggrin? We see that filaggrin has a skipped expression at baseline. This is what usually we see at baseline, but dupilumab normalizes that filaggrin expression, and that's not happening in the placebo arm. So dupilumab impacted both the inflammation, but also the barrier dysfunction of atopic dermatitis, establishing the Th2 axis and IL-4 and IL-13 cytokines as being pathogenic in atopic dermatitis, cementing atopic dermatitis as a reversible and immune-driven disease like psoriasis. And this study really allowed all the therapeutic development that we now have in atopic dermatitis that is amazing now with multiple new agents in clinical development right now. Now, another study that I want to talk about is the IL-22 antagonism with fezakizumab. And IL-22 is another important cytokine in atopic dermatitis. It's important to epidermal hyperplasia. It's also important for the barrier dysfunction that patients with atopic dermatitis has. It's also down-regulating filaggrin, loricrin, and other barrier molecules, and it induces the S100s. And in this study that was a monotherapy study that we did with the anti-IL-22 antagonist, ILV-094, that was sitting on the shelf of Pfizer after it failed two indications in psoriasis and in RA. In this study, we see that there is a downregulation of the SCORAD, the disease scoring, in the group that took anti-IL-22, and those were injections. But we do see that there is not significance at the primary endpoint, week 12. We should have put the primary endpoint at week 20. But when we did in this study, that was a small study, only 60 patients, 2-to-1 to placebo. When we did a multivariate analysis, multivariate regression model, we do see that there is significance at every single week when we take into account severity. And after that, we separated patients to moderate patients, the non-severe patients, SCORAD 25 to 50, and severe patients with SCORAD more than 50. And then we found significance at every single week. And then we asked ourselves, what does it mean? And we had a crazy idea. We divided the patients based on baseline IL-22 expression, either above the median or below the median. And we see, and this is a heat map of gene arrays where red is the upregulation, blue is downregulation. We clearly see that in the group of the high baseline IL-22, there is a very nice modulation. Red is turning into blue, whereas in the placebo, not much is happening. And in the low baseline IL-22, we see actually an exacerbation. The blue turns into red. So not only we did not help patients in this group, but we actually exacerbated them. We made them worse. And this is the first example of a personalized medicine approach taken into atopic dermatitis. And I think many more will follow. And I'm also a clinician. I like to know what different treatments are doing to my patients. And you all will agree with me that it's very difficult to change these highly lichenified lesions as in this patient. And not only it was modified, but it stayed clear 3 months after the treatment. And now I want to switch gears and talk about my passion in recent years, a development of less invasive biomarkers in atopic dermatitis. And here I'm talking about tape strips. And tape strips were introduced as a detection method of melanoma to identify pagetoid melanocytes that are present only in melanomas by superficial tape strips and differentiate from non-melanomas. And this is also a useful technique to study inflammatory skin diseases. It removes stratum corneum and upper granular layer. And the benefits are it's non-invasive, it's scarless, and it's painless. And it goes about almost until the middle of the stratum granulosum, maybe a little bit above the center of the stratum granulosum, depending on how many tapes you are doing. And I want to present a few studies that we have done. This study that was done in collaboration with Robert Bissonnette. In this study, we took 20 tape strips that were taken into atopic dermatitis patients with moderate to severe disease and 20 psoriasis patients also with moderate to severe disease as compared to controls. And we were encouraged when we looked at the heat map of RNA-seq that we have done. And we have done RNA-seq in this tiny, tiny RNA that we obtained from tape strips. And we were encouraged to find a similar number of differentially expressed genes to the ones we find in biopsies. In atopic dermatitis, more than 4,000 genes, and in psoriasis, more than 5,000 genes. Keeping the same criteria like we have in biopsies, fold changes more than 2, and false discovery rate less than 0.05. And when we compare atopic dermatitis and psoriasis, we see the same genes, the same exact genes that we see in skin biopsies as differentiating the two also come into play in tape strips in this RNA-seq study with genes such as CCL17, TARC, CCL22, MDC, TNF-RSF4, OX40, Fc epsilon receptor, IL-13, and CCR4. So multiple Th2 genes being highly upregulated only in AD, not in psoriasis, whereas in psoriasis, we see, as expected, the high Th17 upregulation of genes such as IL-17A, IL-17F, and Th1 and innate immune genes such as NAS2, interferon gamma, and the CXCL9, 10, and 11. Now, we wanted to see whether we can define a molecular classifier between atopic dermatitis and psoriasis using tape strips, similar to what has been done in biopsies. And we need to remember, in biopsies, this has been done using two markers, not one. But here, we were really encouraged by the fact that one single marker was able to 100% differentiate in between psoriasis and atopic dermatitis by PCR and by RNA-seq almost 100%. Really impressive for a single marker, NOS2, that is an accurate classifier between atopic dermatitis and psoriasis in tape strips. Now, let's ask a different question. Can tape strips be used to evaluate biomarkers of therapeutic response in atopic dermatitis? And we answered that too in several studies in which we showed that using dupilumab treatment in real life, so real life treatment of dupilumab, and we evaluated before and after 16 weeks of dupilumab, and we found very similar to skin biopsies, the same modulation of the Th2 markers such as CCL18, CCL13, and others, ICOS markers of T-cell activation. We have OX40 here and many others. So general inflammation, Th17, T-cell activation, terminal differentiation that is improving, markers of dendritic cells, markers of Th2 activation. And then we did another thing. We compared the tape strip study to our study in skin biopsies in a different population, but we wanted to see if the modulation of different markers is in the same direction, and absolutely it is. And I show you only a few markers here, CCL18, CCL13, CCL17, and CCL26, they all are modified in the same direction. In fact, in the non-lesional skin, we see a little bit higher modulation in tape strips as compared to biopsies. Now, importantly, in order for us to call a biomarker, we need to understand whether it's correlated with the disease improvement. And here in this study, the EASI improvement was very similar to the one in the studies, about 70%. And we see high correlation between EASI and the expression of biomarkers in the skin, including in non-lesional skin, such as CCL18 was highly correlated with non-lesional skin, CCL13, and also high correlations with transepidermal water loss. And here I also show you the graph of the correlation, Spearman correlation between CCL13 change and the EASI change, and also multiple correlations with transepidermal water loss and biomarkers in lesional skin. Now, in another study we have done, we wanted to also see if not only RNA-seq biomarkers, but also proteomic biomarkers we are able to use in tape strips. And we utilized Olink proteomics in tape strips with only using two tapes. So pre and post, but only two tapes in each time point. And we saw very similar modulation to that in the RNA-seq expression and in our past study. It was very impressive and significant reductions in multiple markers, such as TARC, CCL17, again, CCL13, and many other biomarkers that we know are modulated with dupilumab from our skin biopsy study. So I think this is very hopeful because we can adapt these studies to pediatric populations and to longitudinal studies. So I hope you share my enthusiasm for a new treatment paradigm in which we can incorporate biomarkers, and particularly non-invasive biomarkers, to our studies. Thank you so much.